Hi and welcome to The Wire's conversation on the healthcare aspects of the budget that was announced today. My name is Anu, I cover health for The Wire, and I'm joined by Avani Kapur, who's the director of the Accountability Initiative, which takes a close look at public funding in India, and by Indranil Mukhopadhyay, who's an associate professor of public policy at Jindal University, also in Delhi. Let me begin by making a comment. You know, Piyush Goyal, when he was presenting the budget today, he began by wishing good health and a speedy recovery to Arun Jaitley, the finance minister, who's currently missing from action because he's unwell. But then the budget went completely silent, really, on healthcare, which is very different from last year, where Ayushman Bharat, the insurance, health insurance scheme, was absolutely glitzy because the government marketed it as the world's largest healthcare program, and that was all that the media was talking about. It also has largely been the big topic of discussion over the last 1 year. But this year, he made about two or three passing references to Ayushman Bharat, and only when the budget documents came out, about an hour later, did we realize that it had seemed like health was not important, or at least Ayushman Bharat was not important. But when the budget documents came out, the scheme has actually been given 6,400 crore, which is up from 2,000 crore that was allocated last year. So let me begin by asking you both, really, what you make. Let's talk about Ayushman Bharat, although there are many things to talk about in healthcare. The fact that the government has ramped it up so much from 2,000 crore to 6,400 crore, which is now 1/10 of the entire health budget. Let me go to Indranil first. What do you make of that?
So first, there are two aspects of it. Whether Ayushman Bharat is the desirable thing to do, and I have a lot to say, I'll come to that later. But because budget is about allocations, it's also see whether this allocation is enough or not. So first year was a initial year planning. You allocate a token amount, 2,400 crores it was, and also a lot of it, as expected, hasn't been spent. Only 6 lakh beneficiaries have got there so far, so underspending is there. But then at the same time, if we believe Niti Aayog and their calculations, which said that the premium of 1,100 to 1,200 rupees per family, if we take out states which have not signed up for the scheme, like Delhi, Chhattisgarh and West Bengal, it's around roughly 7-8 crore families. And if you take that number, 1,200 per family, it becomes a much bigger number, something around 10,000 crores. So this is just to pay premiums. If it is about paying premiums, this is not enough. And then there are recent announcements, which essentially means that the money of the scheme would be also invested in setting up or incentivizing private provisioning.
Yeah,
we can come back to that later. Okay. So that's on the allocation part. Desirability is a larger question, which we can take subsequently. Okay. So this is clearly not adequate given their calculations. And also, if we go by any actuarial calculation, it premium should be more than 10,000 per family of 4 to 5 person. That means that this has to go up to at least 10 times of what it is currently, 20 times in fact. And that is going to consume almost as much as the current union budget allocation. So that, if the scheme has to be implemented in this current spirit. Mm.
Okay.
That's the situation.
Okay. Yeah, we should come back to the desirability also. But Avani, what do you make of this increase in the spending? Because you've been looking at the budget, but also the health budget for many years, and there have been various sort of traditional things that the government has focused on. Now this is a completely new kind of dimension that you have to look at, as you analyze the budget going forward. Are you feeling kind of sure that this is the way we should proceed, or that we are going to proceed, and that we should proceed in terms of health insurance being the answer for taking care of 50 crore people?
So I think, just as you said, two points to note here. One is that Ayushman Bharat saw an increase, but a bulk of that increase was in the insurance scheme. So from 2,400 to 6,400, that's roughly 2.5 times the amount that was allocated. And as Indranil said, it was a token amount initially. I think to pass judgment on utilization right now, it's been slow, definitely. They have only few beneficiaries. We were looking at some of the data. And so, for instance, Kerala admitted about 17% of the total beneficiaries, but no money has been released even in Kerala. But to be fair, it's just starting. The other component of it has been the health and wellness centers, which has also been much talked about. And that's the second pillar, as it were, of Ayushman Bharat, and in some ways a very critical component. We all know that the national disease burden of India is changing. There is a more focus on non-communicable diseases. There's a need to strengthen the very distraught rural infrastructure. And so 1.5 lakhs was the announcement of health and wellness centers. There, I think the allocation has, yes, it has increased from 1,200 to 1,600, but it still seems far below par. So the way that the government had done the year-wise categorization, so 15,000 health and wellness centers were to be operationalized this year, 2018-19. And in fact, the committee, the standing committee had noted that 1,200 crores covers about 10,000 of these health and wellness centers. The ministry had said, okay, there's a state share included in it. So even if that goes up to about 1,900, it still doesn't add up. So if 1,900 crores or 1,200, it covers about 15,000. If you want to cover 25,000 in 2019-20, a 400 crore allocation somehow just doesn't add up.
So is there a sense that there's some selling short that is happening here, in the sense, you know, you're saying one thing, but you're really not putting in, you know, not putting the money where your mouth is, or whatever that phrase is. I mean, is there if deception is a hard word, strong word to use, but some sense that, you know, there's a lack of integrity in these numbers?
I think I'm not sure about integrity, but there's definitely a confusion. If you just look at the rural health statistics that were released in 2018, the proportion of sub-centers and primary health, both sub-center, primary health and community health centers that aren't functioning as per IPHS norms, just basic standards. You don't have the manpower, you don't have the infrastructure, you don't have you don't meet any of the criteria, in which case this aspirational scheme of health and wellness centers, very important, but how far will we be able to do that given the allocations?
So, you know, when we talk about 6,400 crore for Ayushman Bharat, you know, as a whole,
PMAYG,
that's only for the insurance component, and you know, 1,200 crore is for the actual building of, you know, now 1,600,
1,350,
right? So, the insurance component is getting, you know, so much, and that insurance is also targeted at tier 2 and tier 3 cities. The health and wellness centers are supposed to be, you know, at the bottom of the pyramid. That's only getting, you know, around 1,300 or 1,600 crore. Is this proportionate, disproportionate? What does this say about priorities? What does this say about intention? What does this say about honesty?
So I think that one of the things that was very clear, and I think Indu Bhushan ji had also mentioned this quite clearly, if you're talking about decreasing out-of-pocket expenditure, Ayushman Bharat or PMAYJ will only be able to cover very catastrophic expenditure for inpatient care. There's a lot of outpatient expenses that happen on drugs, on outpatient care. And that's where I think the vision at least was that the health and wellness centers will try and take care of those. So I think one element of it is getting a little more highlighted, whereas the second component, I think, is far neglected.
Other critical aspect, while agreeing to Avani completely, is that insurance-based models are essentially cost-escalating models. You will have to, you know, it's going to fuel more, it needs more money to be pumped in without any significant strengthening of system or in a long-term system strengthening. But at the same time, primary care, health and wellness center being a key element to that, these are long-term investment, cost-saving investments. There is an enormous emphasis on prevention, and that is the model we need in a developing country like India. And the health and wellness center is part of the NRHM budget. And if you see NRHM budgets compared to 2017-18 actual expenditure, this time allocation is lesser than that. So then, there is over the years, NRHM actually between 2004-05 and say till 13-14, if you see, growth in NRHM expenditure had been quite high. We saw the results also. a lot of improvements in terms of IMR had happened in this period. We saw that the institutional deliveries have increased, immunization rates have increased, and at the same time people were coming back to public health infrastructure, particularly in rural area. These health and wellness center can actually build on this and create that integration that is needed in there. So I think there we should have taken health and wellness center more critically, but as you have rightly pointed out, there is a lot of talk, but walking the talk is something this government has been missing from the very beginning. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think that's a good, it's probably a good point to talk about the National Health Mission, which includes the rural and the urban health mission. And this, you know, the entire budget for NHM over the last many years has been about half of the entire health budget. Although that, I think, has decreased from 58% to 55% between 2017-18 and 18-19, and I mean, you'll know better what it has decreased from between last year and this year, but also, you know, what are the things that you've been seeing, Avani, as you've studied the NHM component specifically of the overall health budget?
Sure. So, just to again add to what Indraneel had said, even last year, the ministry had asked for about 35,000 crores, 34,800 and something crores. And this year's allocation, 1 year later, interim budget, remains below that. So yes, NHM has increased marginally, I think 3% or a marginal increase. But when you look at it in terms of what the ministry had even requested, it remains far below. And this is something that's been commented about time and again. And in fact, even the committee had raised serious concerns that how are you going to be able to meet all your targets, meet all the new interventions that you want to meet if you're not putting enough money into it. What's been worrying is that, as we've seen over a period of time, the reproductive child health component of NHM has been falling. So it fell from 40% as a share of the total NHM budget to 15%. And what's worrying even
now... So what you're saying is the NHM component of the overall health budget has been falling, and the reproductive child component of that NHM budget has also been falling.
Exactly.
But the fall has been from 40% of that to 15% of that, yeah, which is pretty serious.
Yeah. And in fact, even if you look at this year's budget, if you just look at the breakdown of NHM, you can see that again RCH is falling. So from 17-18 RE to 18-19 RE, there was over a 30% fall, 24% fall. And then if you look at it from compared to this year's budget estimates, it's still an 8% fall. So while one is talking on one hand about importance of maternal health, child health, and we do know that India is one of the leading, as a maternal and child malnutrition is one of the leading causes of deaths in India, it still hasn't got the kind of priority that it needs, and in fact has been falling.
One of the things I want to add here, if you look at last few years, you will see that every year allocation has been less than what has been spent actually on ground. So every time there has been attempt from the central government to cut NRHM expenditure or NHM expenditure, and there have been pressures from the state later on, because these are demand driven scheme, there are many components, and utilization has increased, so you give us more money. In fact, last year before budget, the health minister had complained that the money that is needed to keep things going on had not been given by the finance minister. So this shows the design that though there is a need, there is a increased capacity at the state level to spend more, you are not able to. So yeah, one more
now. This is true of NREGA also. I mean, we're carrying a story today about how this is true of NREGA, that the, you know, the allocation this year is less than the utilization of last year.
Yeah. I'll just give a striking number. Growth rate of NRHM expenditure, 2005-09, it had been 13.5, double digit every year, average growth rate. It went down 2009-14, it was 10%. 2014-2018, it is minus 0.5%. So it is in real terms, there is a decline. So, and it's a serious concern that we need to really flag and keep.
Yeah. I mean, just two things. You know, India, we spend about 8 times more on defense than we spend on healthcare, you know, and we've been saying this, it's a cliche really that we spend so little on healthcare, we spend only about 1% of our GDP on healthcare, but we spend 8 times how much, I mean, including in this budget, you know, that we spend on healthcare, we're spending on defense. I just want to come back to RCH and segue into just one thing, because Piyush Goyal said we must not have women development, we must have women-led development, and RCH predominantly is concerned about women and, you know, maternal aspects of women and what women are doing with their bodies are functioning and how their bodies function in their reproductive manners. And yet I just want to speak to this, you know, what kind of role you see in policy making that women have or women don't have, because even, you know, a lot of pictures that the government has been tweeting about, you know, budget preparation, budget discussion, you know, I don't see women as part of that. So on the one hand, the government says women are important. On the other hand, we're seeing budgets that impact women, which is, you know, whether it's the Janani Suraksha Yojana or whether it's, a larger RCH is falling. So what role do women have in the budget in terms of being cared for by the budget, but also even before the budget even happens in terms of policy making? Just a little bit of a segue into that. Avani, maybe you want to...
Go to the cliche woman on the panel.
Okay.
No.
Okay. So I have a few...
Actually, 1 minute. Can Avani take that first? I think Avani should take that first. Huh?
So I think... It's been confusing. A lot of the, even today's speech talked a lot about Ujjwala as one of the ways of women empowerment. I think that's...
Yeah, I just want to quote Piyush Goyal on that actually, because it was quite stunning. You know, he said women development, we should move to women-led development. And then the first thing he said about that, I thought he's going to say something about jobs for women or something. That's what he said. Clean fuel, because to ensure she does not have to shed tears for cooking food to nourish her family. And so the government has embarked on this project. So the woman should not shed tears while cooking food. That is what they mean by women-led development. Yeah. So anyway, Avani, go on.
So if you see a lot of schemes that were women targeted, apart from the RCH component of National Health Mission, you had the maternity, the Matru Vandana Yojana, which again, I think in some ways is a very progressive scheme. Just the fact that you are giving, it's of course part of the National Food Security Act, it's a legal entitlement, but the fact that you're compensating women for wage loss during the time that they are pregnant, it is important to recognize the fact that there is a wage loss there. But again, there the allocations were confusing. From 2400 crores in the budget estimates, which were already touted by everyone to be very low compared to what would be required to fulfill the National Food Security Act, it dropped to 1200 crores in the revised estimates. And this year now they've increased it back to 2500. So it's a little confusing in terms of when you're saying women-led schemes and women-led empowerment, I'm a little confused about what that exactly translates to. Swachh Bharat is another scheme that they've talked a lot about in terms of how it's targeted towards women. But there also we've actually seen, we did a study in 2017 and we saw sometimes it was misconstrued where the scheme started being seen as only for women rather than a larger public health, narrative of the importance of defecating safely and safe sanitation.
So, if I may just add, if you are talking about women-led development, then what about the women who are working in the health sector? Because at the ground, the Anganwadi workers, the ASHA workers, the ANMs, they are the harbingers of change. And you are not... So, there has been enormous struggles that ASHA workers be given a minimum wage. Anganwadi workers are fighting for a decent and minimum wage. There is no response. Some states have responded sporadically, but this union government remains silent about this. And these are probably pathways if you really want to make it women-centric.
To be fair, though, they just announced an increase. They doubled.
But the increase is so little for ASHA workers.
Yeah, it's very little, but they did double it. And that's why the ICDS budget is increased, but it is primarily because of this component. So they have increase it, to be fair, but yeah, it's still far below. But what is interesting is a lot of states are compensating. We found that a lot of states end up putting a lot more money, and that's what's needed because they are playing that critical, pivotal role at the last mile.
So, you know, I think there's lots that we can discuss, but we should wrap up in a bit. I just want to perhaps end on this one question where you guys can also maybe, you know, give your closing thoughts, but also respond to this question, which is, I was going through all of the 6 speeches that this government has had on the budget. And it's only in the 2017-18 budget that they started talking about like hard health issues, where they spoke about, you know, various disease targets, all of which we've missed. And the next budget spoke about Ayushman Bharat. And now this budget, you know, has increased the Ayushman Bharat allocation. But the early budgets were whenever, you know, the finance minister wanted to talk about health, he was speaking about Ujjwala, which is, you know, giving LPG and clean fuel to women. He was speaking speaking about Swachh Bharat, open defecation, clean Ganga, drinking water. So just in terms of, you know, looking at the previous government and also this government, there was a very classical way of looking at health, you know, which predominantly national health mission, you know, communicable diseases, non-communicable diseases, you know, this this very sort of dal roti way of looking at health. This government, I wonder if, you know, could we say that they have given us a more holistic way of looking at health, you know, when we, because now, for example, all these pollution reports that have been coming out have also been talking about indoor pollution, which is not something we think about when we think about pollution. But when you talk about indoor pollution, then that's an aspect which Ujwala is concerned about. And that's an aspect that directly concerns the health of women, you know, specifically, not really men. So, you know, what can we say about this larger scope of health thinking that we now have, you know, maybe Avani?
So I think in terms of narrative, definitely, the government has broadened the narrative of health, where it's talking a lot about health and nutrition, talking a lot about sanitation and clean water. I don't think that the numbers add up. So while there was so much focus on building toilets under Swachh Bharat, the drinking water scheme was completely neglected. We missed the targets that we had set for ourselves, and there was silence on those topics. I think 18% of rural households have pipe water supply. The coverage of, in terms of just 55 liters per person per day, has basically remained at 44% since 2014. So I think we are able to, while we talk about a holistic vision, I don't think we're able to actually implement that or actually put numbers behind it. So you prioritizing sanitation but neglecting water, you're prioritizing insurance but neglecting primary healthcare. Yeah, so right. It's a bit
right. And I would read it slightly differently. There are two aspects on health sector specifically. Actually, a lot of this government has done nothing significantly new, you know. RSBY was there, they gave it a new name, expanded the coverage. Huh? NRHM was doing good. There was a talk about strengthening the sub-centers. The high-level expert committee 12 plan had talked about expanding. They gave it a new name, which is the health wellness center. There was a lot of momentum before this government that medicine is a key element. And the first speech, the Prime Minister said, the Independence Day speech, that he wants to ensure free medicine, but nothing happened on that front. The other thing is that this government talked about for a good 3-4 years that we are about small government and it's about governance. And this budget, when you are not actually going to implement, make this money available to people, you are compromising on your paradigm and trying to make it what we call a popular budget. If the government was serious about people's life, it would have done 4 years back, from the very beginning. So I don't see this as a, like, you know, the paradigm change in the thinking, expanding the horizon, nothing. It has rather compromised on many of the developments that were taking place. The Planning Commission had played a major role in expanding the discourses on health. That has been completely compromised. So I see it very differently.
Let me just ask you, I did say that was going to be the last question, but, you know, for a long time, people have wondered why health and education and generally social sector, you know, kind of verticals, agriculture, you know, these kind of issues, they're not political, or they're not political enough. Is there a feeling that, you know, health is suddenly a political issue? Because, and I think given the fact that, you know, various opposition governments in the states are showing a lot of resistance, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. In the end, do the people benefit at all? Is this any more about policy, or is this all about politics and what happens to the people in this bargain? Indraneel, maybe you want to take that first.
Okay, thanks. This is a very good question. So this has been the phenomenon, that health has not been so important, not only in India, but in this region, South Asian region. We spend, all of our country spend very low amount of money in public health, apart from Sri Lanka. But yes, it has become, for last 10 years, we see changes. And it's not only because there is this narrative that insurance schemes have made that difference. If you look at Rajasthan, the free medicine initiative became very popular. There was a campaign by the next government that this is not medicine, but poison. So they wanted to dismantle that. But there was popular pressure and resistance from the down. So they had to continue. So health is becoming an issue, and just that we are trying to take it in a particular direction, which is of unregulated commercialization and this is a matter of serious concern, I think we should resist it until unless we see that there is evidence. And frankly, there is no evidence, not a single public-private partnership has worked in India, and we are, there is no evidence on that, but we keep repeating, we bring the new old wine into new bottle and try to give it a new name. It's not working.
And Avani, to you, I mean, in the what is essentially at its heart, it's a policy issue. But you know, are we losing it to politics?
I'm not convinced that it's a political issue for this current government. I'm just going by since this was the last speech of the current government, there was no mention of education. There was barely any mention of health, and most of the focus was on farmers and tax
for the middle class.
So. While it is definitely for locals, I think that there is a change, and we do see that as in terms of local issues, health does matter. But I don't think for this current government, at least from what the budget speech seemed to suggest, I don't think yet that it's a political issue yet.
Okay. On that note, I think let's just wrap up because, I mean, Piyush Goyal did say out of the 10 dimensions that this government was looking at, health was the 9th dimension. And he said healthy India will be built with the participation of women. However, we see that the budget itself, the numbers are not really caring about women. And the focus was really on farmers, which is a good thing. And the focus was on the middle class. Which is possibly very good for them politically as well. And Piyush Goyal said, and I think this is notable for me, he said, the tax you pay will provide healthcare to 50 crore brothers and sisters and children. Thank you, taxpayers. So I hope health continues to be important, even though farmers and the middle class have, you know, kind of been given the boost this time around. But thank you for watching, and thanks to our guests. More for health coverage on The Wire.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.